When most people think of a space shooter, this is what they imagine.
Yeah, this is Alpha One. I'm just gonna dodge all these lasers.
Here's that same scene in a space simulator.
Oh god, what am I doing in this unshielded craft? I'm too close to the station. Panic, panic, panic!
Get off my lawn! Rewind your internal clocks all the way back to the glory days of 1994 when the internet was beginning to boom, and so was the concept of multimedia PCs, home systems that were capable of handling fully three-dimensional models while blasting high-quality digital sound out of newly attached speakers. Lucasfilm Games, now known as LucasArts, hallowed be their name, were already a player in the PC market with 12 years of game development experience. They waded into the world of DOS gaming with the likes of PHM Pegasus and its unofficial sequel, Strike Fleet. It was their adventure games that really set the world on fire, though. We'll cover those particular triumphs in a later video. From 1988 to 1991, LucasArts contracted a company called Totally Games to release a series of flight simulators. Battle Hawks 1942, Their Finest Hour, and Secret Weapons of the Luftwaffe are what followed, each of them to glowing reviews. The creator, Lawrence Holland, caught the attention of one Chris Roberts, who reportedly reverse-engineered Battle Hawks in order to start his own Wing Commander series. We'll cover those particular triumphs in... So anyways, this Lawrence Holland guy was in their good graces, and as a reward, LucasArts threw him a license to print money. The Star Wars IP. And the result was... We're not going to talk about that. Sort of like his previous games, but in space or something. I think there were rumors about 500,000 copies ordered and it being a bestseller. Anyway, a year and a half later, it got a deserved sequel, one that surpassed all expectations. In TIE Fighter, you play the bad guy. Except from your perspective, what you're doing isn't really that bad. You're more a peacekeeper for the Empire, maintaining order and whatnot by flying around space in an unshielded death machine that can take two or three laser hits before. Like I said at the start, this is no arcade game. You can't just fly in all guns blazing and watch the fun explosions. Much like its ancestors and immediate predecessor, this is a flight simulation. If you get cocky or gung-ho, you'll get slapped out of your craft faster than you can say Porkins. All the footage you're seeing now is from the glorious 1995 Collector's Edition, which boosted the resolution of the game's SVGA graphics and added full voice acting, amongst other things. That's the version you want to be playing, but more on that later. TIE Fighter begins with a delightful Imperial officer demanding you enter your name. You'll already be hearing the wonderful military refrains of the game's I'm You soundtrack. You best give the man a name, otherwise you'll not be allowed to play. The concourse is where the game selection takes place. The bottom left room takes you back to the registration if you want to play as another pilot. Useful if you have a little brother who also wanted to play. Remember, this was made a decade before Steam and digital distribution was commonplace. People often shared computers in the good old days. Or at least tried to. The training simulator is a big tunnel that you fly laps around, sort of like NASCAR but with spaceships, with each lap getting increasingly difficult until it becomes impossible to finish a lap with enough time remaining. Each lap completed grants a little more time, and each of the obstacles you shoot grants additional precious seconds. Turrets start shooting at you, and eventually things get really hairy. It's like the sentient shapes got tired of you destroying them and decided to fight back. The next room lets you pick the campaign you wish to engage in. Four campaigns are available off the bat, and I'd strongly advise you do them in order. Each mission takes anywhere between 10 and 30 minutes, with some lasting even longer. There are usually between 5 and 6 missions in each campaign, so accounting for mistakes, and you will make some, there's around 2 or 3 hours to each tour of duty. There's 7 tours of duty in the base game, 3 in the first expansion pack and 3 in the second, resulting in a vast 13 tours of duty, giving you a campaign that's at least 30 hours long. To continue with a selected tour of duty, use the big convenient door at the top. First though, it's important to get some practice in. The combat chamber is the perfect place to do it. Each craft has a series of practice missions carefully tailored to improve your capabilities with the vessel in question before flying in the proper mission. In reality, each of these ships has a mini-campaign of 4 missions. Combined with the campaign and the expansion packs that followed, that gives you over 100 missions to fly. But if you want to know what you'll be flying alongside and up against, your next port of call is the film room, detailing each craft and listing its capabilities. Had enough of entering doors, finding the game impossible to beat? Just need a break from the music? Hit escape. Here you'll enter your Imperial database, allowing for rudimentary changes in resolution and sound, not to mention the difficulty level. More interesting is the ability to back up and restore pilots, so you can take your achievements with you to another machine, which is totally a relevant thing to do in the Steam era. There's also the medal section, showing your training certificates and campaign rewards as well as your record, which is the game telling you how awesome you are and how many craft you've destroyed. Pretty neat for such an old game, right? On the far left is your sleeve. That's not important now, but it will be later. Oh yeah, and you can also quit the game from here, but really, why would anyone want to do that? Let's go to the most important person in the game other than ourselves. Once you've selected the first campaign, you'll be taken to a room with a solitary flight officer, also known as your briefing officer. This man will give you almost everything you need to know about the upcoming mission. While lacking lip sync, he does have the pleasure of being voiced by the wonderful Guy Sinair of Allo Allo fame. Look it up, kids. Great show. Only it was also in some film called Pirates of the Caribbean. Never heard of it. So our briefing officer will tell us our mission objectives. The craft will be lumped with in the opposition. But wait, there's more. Once you're done being friendly to that nice Imperial man with the wonderful voice, you get the classic mission board showing you the map of the space you'll be patrolling and giving you an idea of what you'll be heading into before debarkation. There's a closed room that'll feature another individual in later missions. It's all related to the sleeve I was talking about earlier. But I'm not going to provide spoilers for a 25-year-old game. The bottom doors will take you back to the concourse or launched mission. Don't confuse them now. Once entering a mission, you may be given the option to set your loadout. Since you're a complete scrub flying a basic TIE fighter, you'll not have that opportunity at first. As soon as you hit escape and flight, you can determine some other options. There's one important section that allows you to toggle invulnerability. For folks who just want to enjoy the fantastic story, and trust me it is, you can still lose missions if you screw up objectives, so keep an eye out. Speaking of objectives, if you hit escape again and press G, it'll bring up your mission logs. In order to complete the mission, the primary goals must be completed. The secondary mission goals aren't essential, but it's pretty sweet to get them done too, and they're plot-related, so you really should. There are also hidden bonus goals that are unlisted. You might stumble across them by accident or by Google Foo. The choice is yours. The biggest hurdle you face now is the clever design of the first mission. You're heading towards a space station. Directly towards a space station. You haven't bothered to train in the simulators, have you? You don't know what's up and what's down. And if you don't know how to move, so off you go to the simulators. That voice you hear over the intercom? Get used to it. There's an absolute boatload of transmissions, giving you contextual information and updating you on the status of mission-critical craft as well as developing the story mid-flight. What's fun about TIE Fighter is that there's four options to get out of a mission. By quitting outright with a Q button followed by space, which gives you no cutscenes, by crashing and burning and being recovered by the Imperial medical team, by crashing and burning and being enslaved by the rebels, and by actually doing your damn job of not crashing and burning and returning safely. After mastering the training missions and figuring out what's up and down, you're off to the proverbial races. Whether you choose to be an invulnerable death machine with unlimited ammo or a tin can floating in the vastness of space ready to explode at any minute, the missions will play out the same. Unlike a certain other game, which wouldn't progress if you decided to be invulnerable. Even if you do choose the latter, TIE Fighter is old school in its difficulty. It requires a lot of prioritization, and its control scheme is extensive. This was back when you really did have to read the manual, kids. I'd also highly recommend a joystick for it. But you can get away with a controller if you map keys accordingly. There are a few masochists who use mouse and keyboard, but they're plain bonkers if you ask me. Once you've mastered the basics of handling the craft, you'll be ducking, weaving, and alternating energy throughout your systems and prioritizing target like nobody's business. TIE Fighter did get a remaster in 1998, which took it to a whole new engine and gave it texture mapping and 3D acceleration, but at the cost of both its wonderful soundtrack and blighting it with a swath of compatibility issues. Since the soundtrack is part of what makes the game so special and DOSBox is close to perfect at emulating every aspect of the game, I say stick with the Collector's Edition. For a comprehensive look at how to set up TIE Fighter perfectly on your machine, go visit Phil's Computer Lab on YouTube and follow his instructions. I personally use CoolSoft Virtual MIDI for the STM sound font. That's what we've been playing with in this background the whole time. The retro aesthetic of the Gurard shading combined with the SVG graphics mean that TIE Fighter doesn't suffer from outdated textures. And because Space Sims died a death around 1999, there's very little in the way of modern games that emulate what this masterpiece did so many years ago. While there haven't been any remakes as of yet to surpass the Collector's Edition, there is a mod that imports the TIE Fighter campaigns into X-Wing Alliance. Trust me though, while the graphics are much improved, the presentation isn't as good. Instead, I offer a massive shout-out to the wonderful XWVM team, who are creating an engine replacement using Unity that can emulate the original files of X-Wing in order to make it playable. They have plans to incorporate TIE Fighter in due course, provided Disney don't make the cataclysmically bad decision of shutting them down. They have no reason to, but when has that ever stopped a big corporation from protecting its intellectual property? Why did space shooters die around 1999? Did I mention Free Space 2? Anyway, that concludes the first video. And if you've enjoyed it, subscribe, bell, all that jazz, you know. Until then, you kids can feel free to get off my lawn.
Spice is the most precious substance. It can be found only on one planet in the whole universe. That planet is Arrakis, better known as Dune.